Welcome to another Lync and Learn session. My name is Josh Topel, and I'm one of the community program managers for Office 365. If this is your first time, let me tell you what Lync and Learn is. The Lync and Learns are online community sessions that we take our Office 365 experts and let them talk about a topic of their choice. We've done several of these, and we're really happy to have John Ventry leading our latest Lync and Learn session. So a little bit about John. John is a member of the Office 365 grid and community, and he's a 17-year technology professional. He's currently working as an Office 365 and SharePoint expert, and he's a consultant for the St. Charles Consulting Group. So today's session will focus on Office 365 and Android. And it'll be, we have about an hour for today's session. I think it won't go that long, but we encourage you to ask questions, and we'll be taking those questions at the end. We'll have a Q&A. So in the bottom left, if you're not familiar with Lync, you can go ahead and type your questions, and if you can, save them till the end. If not, I'll be recording the questions, and we'll get to those when we get to the question and answer session towards the end of the presentation. Yeah, that's really it. That's John, are you ready to give a little introduction and get going?
I am. Thanks, Josh.
All right, great.
Well, thanks, everybody, for taking time out this afternoon to join on this session. As Josh said, my name is John Ventry, and we're going to be talking about accessing Office 365 on Android devices. So can everybody hear me okay? Okay. Just wanted to make sure. So, real briefly, Josh gave the bio about me. I've been in the technology field for 17 years. I come from an IT infrastructure background of Windows Server and Exchange, and currently work as a SharePoint Office 365 consultant evangelist for St. Charles Consulting Group. So, that's the quick bio. The background on this session is that I actually am not an Android evangelist. I'm not here to push the Android platform or anything like that. I am simply an Android user. So a couple years ago when I went to go get a smartphone, the only smartphone that my carrier had available, or I should say the best smartphone that my carrier had available at that time was an Android phone. So that's what I purchased. So that's kind of my background with it. I'm not here to push a platform related to phones or tablets or anything along that line. I actually have Androids and iPads and that sort of thing. But when I went to configure my Android phone to work with 365, there is kind of a gotcha involved with it. It was not as smooth as some of the other platforms I had used, so did some troubleshooting and that kind of thing, and just kind of wanted to pass along my knowledge of that and share that today. We're basically going to walk through two different setups today, and that's the agenda today. We'll be talking through setting up an Android phone, which the phone that I used, for example, in this example, is a Samsung Exhibit 2. It's a 4G phone. And then also we'll be walking through the setup on an Android tablet, which is a Dell Street tablet. And then after we walk through those, there'll be screenshots of that, talking through that. And then at the very end, we'll have a Q&A session on any questions in regards to that. The first step in configuring any Android device to save ourselves from headache down the road is to actually log into Office 365 Outlook Web App first, because there's some information that we're going to need in regards to that that will make our life much easier down the road. So the very first step is what I did is I just signed into my Outlook Web App. In the very top of my Outlook Web App, there's a URL there. There's a server name. So in this case, it's sn2prd0710.outlook.com. Yours may be the same. Yours may be different. But the very first step is to actually go through and record this URL, either write it down on a piece of paper or copy and paste it, whatever you want. But this will be necessary down the road, and will save some headache down the road as well. So in the first scenario, we have a Samsung Exhibit 2. I have the model number there, SGH-T679, Android version of 2.3.5, and the build is Gingerbread VKJ1. So the very first step in setting up the phone is to actually go under the applications and scroll over to the settings icon. And once we're there, we're going to go down to Accounts and Sync. And once we get down to the Accounts and Sync section of the phone, what we're going to do is we're going to add an account. And it'll be a little bit different on the phone versus the tablet because it's referred to in different terms, and we'll talk through that here in just a second. So on the phone, it's referred to as Microsoft Exchange Active Sync, and we'll see later on down the road in talking about the tablet configuration that is actually referred to as corporate. So we'll be looking for one of those two terms, either the Exchange Active Sync or the corporate account type is what we will be looking for. And what I'm going to do in this step is actually walk through the process of what happened to me the first time I went through it. So I get my phone, I go in and I say, hey, I want to configure my email to work with my Android phone. I'm going to enter in my email, I'm going to enter in my password, kind of the similar thing what I did on some other devices. And then I just click Next. Samsung gives me that their user agreement as far as using their phone to access data and access mail, and I have to accept that in order to utilize this feature. And then it comes in and asks me for, I have my email address, I have my domain, which is the domain I own there, my username and password. And at this point, I'm thinking everything's going pretty well because I have all the necessary information in there. I click Next, leave everything else to the default, and then I get this great error message of failed to search Exchange server automatically, enter settings manually. So this next screen that I want to show, I actually could go directly to by saying doing a manual setup. But the tendency is when I get a new device or new through the automatic setup, because in a lot of cases that works for me, I don't have to go through and do manual configuration. Anyway, we end up in the same spot. So this is where that URL comes in handy that we saw earlier. So, and then I'm going to enter in my domain up there so that thejohnmitry.com is the domain, / my username, just John.mitry is the username on that, my password, and then I would enter in my Exchange server name, which is the URL, the full URL is seen here, with a .outlook.com extension on it. Leave all the other settings as the default settings. Those two are checked by default on my phone, and I select Next. I get the remote security administration message. The server requires security features not supported by your device, so there's some security features enabled on the Exchange side that aren't enabled on my phone that won't be available. I don't know exactly all the ins and outs of what it is on this particular device. I'd have to go through the Samsung website to find out. And that's going to vary by device. For example, when we talk through the tablet scenario later on, the tablet doesn't give me that error message at all. So this is actually a device-related error message. And then it's going to display a list of account options that we're going to have. So the recommended setting for the peak schedule, and some devices may not have a peak and off-peak schedule, it may just be a schedule. The recommended setting is push. However, keep one thing in mind. The push is going to pull, so whenever I get a new message, it's going to come to my phone automatically. I don't have to wait for the phone to go out and pull the server and pull the mail down. However, if I select push, it could generate a lot more data. So if I don't have an unlimited data plan, I may not want to do the push setting. And the other thing in regards to the push setting is it can eat up a lot more battery. Once again, it depends on the amount of email that's going through and that sort of thing. So, you know, your experience may vary depending upon that, but that's just a word of caution on using the push. Personally, mine, unlike the screenshot, mine's actually configured to use push because those situations don't apply to me, but just something to point out in setting that up. And the off-peak schedule, basically, I can change for different days if I wanted to maybe only have my phone check email every 4 or 6 hours on the weekend as opposed to checking every 15 minutes during the week. If I kind of want to be able to unplug and still have my phone with me, that's kind of what that's utilized for. And in the period to sync email, I can go back in this case. I'm only going to sync email for the past 3 days. I can change that setting. There's a number of options there. And really the purpose of that is so that all the memory on the phone is not taken up by email. So we can set that setting however we want. And the email retrieval size, I left mine at 2K, which means that when I receive an email message, if it's a fairly lengthy message, I may have to select a button that says more details to pull more of the message down. But it kind of gives me a good feel for the majority of the message, and I can decide if I want to read and process all that message at that time. And then finally, the period to sync the calendar. It's the same purpose there for not wanting to take up all the memory in the phone. I can choose how often or how much time period I want to set for that. And I will actually answer that question on the m.outlook.com. Yes, I've used the m.outlook.com server. That's worked with various devices. On mine, personally, it didn't work. But I've seen it work in other cases. So that would work fine. If you're running into the m.outlook.com not working, which in this case is what happened to me, then this would be the avenue to choose. And then finally, the other thing is if I want to send an email from this account by default, I have a couple of other email accounts set up on my phone. This isn't my default account. I would leave that unchecked. Notify me when email arrives. Sync contacts. I can also sync my calendar and sync my tasks as well. And I utilize those capabilities. You may not want to do that, but that's available as well. And the final one I'll point out is a sync SMS. So if I actually want to have my text messages come to my email, I can have that set up. I tested this for a little while. Personally, I didn't like it, but I will also say for some legal standpoints, if you're getting personal text messages and it's going to your corporate email address, you may just want to think through that some. I can think of some good use cases where that may apply. Maybe you're traveling overseas and you don't have your cell phone with you, but you can still get text messages on your email. You can reply back via your computer and that sort of thing. But just FYI on that. But every single text message you receive would come through to your email and be available for reply as well. And then finally, in setting up the account, I give the account a name, whatever I want to call it. I select Done, and voila, it's there set up under my accounts. The other thing I'll point out are some settings in regards to that. Oh, I didn't come through. I had a PowerPoint crash last night, so we'll move forward. So we'll go through the second scenario, which is the Dell Streak 7 tablet. It's running Android version 3.2. The steps on it are going to be pretty similar. There's a couple little different variants, but overall, they're pretty much the same. So on the Dell Streak, I actually go into Settings, Accounts, and Sync, and then there's an Add Account selection. Notice there at the top. And then here the account type is corporate. So as we saw earlier, the Exchange Active Sync is a little bit different terminology, but it works pretty much the same way. In this situation, the scenario is a little bit different. I entered in my email address, my password, and then my server name. So my server name, and I would have my domain and username as it was up there at the top there. So by default, just pointing this out, by default, it's defaulting to the server name of sccg.com. That's where I want to change that to outlook.com. Like I said, in some situations, as was pointed out, m.outlook.com will work, but this has always worked for me, whereas I've had mixed reviews on entering my information. And then I get a remote security administration message saying that requires me to allow it to remotely control this device, which is totally different than my phone. My phone didn't support some of that configuration. So the phone gave me a different message. I would select OK. And then this is where I would actually go into my inbox checking frequency if I want to do a push. In this case, it's just a Wi-Fi enabled tablet, so push is what I would want to use. I could also synchronize. And the configurations there are pretty much the same. And then at this point, I get an activate device administration message. Pretty much, I have to activate it. If I cancel, it cancels the setup altogether, so I have enough to activate it. And then, voila, there's a picture of what the email looks like within the Dell Streak. And then real quick, information Josh put out on that, and then I'll take some of the questions. So the question of how important is the domain and user field, in my experience, has been very important. So what I have seen is typically I have to put in the domain as the, for example, whatever.com/, and then my username, and then the password. That's what I've had to do in the past. That's what I've encountered. And then, yes, being the other work where you just enter in your email address, and it works as well. So on the Streak, it seemed to work with either the email address or the domain, but on the phone, I've had it work where I had to actually do the domain/username. So I know that doesn't cover everything, but yes, answer that question. I have seen it work in both situations. So as my experience with Android, nothing has been 100% on me for the Android, so I had to play around with that some.
Great. And then do you have a response to Patricia's question? Asks, what about the m.outlook.com server? I used it to configure some customer accounts.
Yes, I've used that some situations as well. On my phone, that didn't work. On the Streak, it did work. And I had another phone before this one that was a Samsung Galaxy where that did not work as well. So I've had mixed reviews. I've had one situation out of four where that worked. But yes, I mean, that procedure is definitely valid. That's definitely a way where if it works, take it. But if that one doesn't work.
Great. Are there any other questions? Great presentation, first of all, John.
Thank you.
And then while people are thinking about any additional questions, I wanted to put down the community accounts for myself and John, so that if you have any additional questions you think of later, feel free to contact me, and we can get those answered.
Yeah. And I'm actually on the grid at least once or twice a day as well, so.
Great. That's perfect. Let's see. Oh, that looks, all right, we got one person typing. Thanks.
I know it was kind of a quick presentation, but there's only so many slides you go into on the configuration of it.
Right. And then, so also, John was talking about possibly doing some follow-up Link and Learns. So yeah, if you want to shoot a message on some different subjects that you'd like to hear, we can try to get the best people for that. I'm going to end the video recording now, but that's going to be up on the Office 365 blog, the original blog post that you saw, this Link and Learn. Oh, and here's another question.
Yeah, if I have contacts, how do I get them to come over? I haven't come up with an automatic way to do that. I've always gone from 365 to the phone. One way, you know, not a good way to do that, but one way is you could email them out or send them over to yourself. But I haven't gone into depth on that one in particular. I have to research that a little bit more to see if there's a different way.
Great. If you have any additional questions, I'll stick around for a couple more minutes. John, I don't know if you have time to hang on for a minute or two.
Yeah, I have
to see if anything else pops up.
Yeah, I do.
All right, great. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining, and we'll see you at the next Link and Learn. Thanks a lot. Just keep your eyes out on the Office 365 community for those.